All right, so hopefully you've watched my video on how photogrammetry works. If not, here's a quick review. Basically, the algorithms work on two principles. One is being able to match colors between photographs to identify spots that are the same in the photograph. So you can see the spots I've identified in the Diabloceratops cast there by the red point and purple point and green point. And the second is parallax, which is a principle that as you sort of move and translate around, the object changes shape in different positions, and it changes shape in certain ways. So as I get into how you want to take photographs for photogrammetry, we need to keep these principles in mind in order to get the best possible photographs that the algorithms can actually compile into a 3D model. So let's go through some color matching requirements first. One of the key things you need to get good models is good lighting. And this is going to be the type of lighting that has the minimal amount of shadows. So diffuse, even, very low shadow. So on the left, you can see my cat in very sort of high contrast lighting, got very dark shadows, and then a very light on top. And in a photogrammetry setting, that would be bad because either, depending on how you're doing it, the program will just not be able to align things at all because in some pictures, the object is shadowed and in others, the part of the object is in light. And that really changes the color and intensity and prevents it from color matching. Or even if you do get something out at the other end, you might just get those shadows baked into the texture that you're working on. Which you generally don't want. So what we want to aim for, again, is more like the picture on the right, this even diffuse lighting. Next, and this is probably one of the trickiest things for fossils, objects need to be relatively matte and very opaque. So opaque, not an issue with fossils. Translucence is a problem, but probably not one most of you will be running into. But shininess is a problem, and I have seen that on a lot of fossils, either fossil teeth where it's just sort of inherent to the preservation, or from consolidant that can often cause a problem. And if we watch this video, you'll see why. So as I move the shell, this sort of specular highlight will stay in the same position in all the photographs. And what that means is these points are going to be white on different parts of the object, which of course will throw off our color matching because it's going to sort of identify this as the same color, but it's in all these different positions. There are workarounds for this. You might try, you might need really, really diffuse lighting. So here it's in a light box, but you can still see the reflection of the light at the top. You might need to use some sort of a spray to sort of make the object more matte and reduce the shininess. It's sort of just going to depend on what you're working with, and especially if you're working with fossils, if you can sort of apply something to the fossil or if you need to come up with another solution. Another thing that shouldn't be too much of an issue though with fossils is variability in color. So because this works on a color matching principle, something that's all the same color, like this 3D print I'm showing here, is going to have a very difficult time matching up different points, unless they're in shadow, which as I covered, we really want to avoid. However, most fossils have plenty of variability in color that is really great for this type of process. So here on this fossil turtle, you can see all of these sort of different speckles of lighter and darker browns and the lines, and all of that will make for very good photogrammetry. And then parallax has some slightly different requirements. So the main key with parallax is that the camera has to be changing position and not just rotating relative to the object. And we'll go into the two different ways you can set up your photogrammetry and what that looks like. But really the main thing is that you cannot just sit and rotate a camera around. You have to be physically moving it or physically moving the specimen relative to the camera. Another important principle is that every point on the object is visible in at least two photos, and preferably three to four. So you really want a lot of coverage and a lot of smooth coverage, so that gives the program a chance to interpolate between two photographs. So now getting into the two different approaches it take, you can either move the camera relative to the object, or you can move the object relative to the camera. And I'll show examples of what these look like. So moving the object or the camera relative to the object is going to be better for bigger objects, like the Diabloceratops cast shown here. I basically had the cast just sitting in the middle of the room there and then walked around and took pictures from different angles. A more consistent setup that I think will be better if you really want to get into photogrammetry for digitizing lots of smaller things is this moving the object relative to the camera, or what I'll call the turntable method, where essentially you put the object in this sort of backgroundless void and you rotate the object around with the camera at a distance, which has the same effect as moving the camera around the object. And one important difference you can see here is this is a little easier because you can have all this background stuff in the back of your images, and in fact it will actually help the program align your pictures. Whereas if you're moving the object around, you can have basically no background stuff at all. You need as blank a background as possible, because otherwise you will have sort of conflicting information as the object moves relative to the background. So you need this sort of white void. So once you've got your setup determined, you're basically going to take photos in rings at different heights from different angles. And you generally want about 25 to 30 pictures in each ring, but you'll need more with complex objects where there's different portions obscuring sort of different facets of the object. Especially for paleontologists, if you're interested in applying this method to mounted skeletons, those are going to require a lot of pictures for each rings, because the ribs conflicting with each other can really be hard on the program. So they need a lot of information in those areas of high detail in order to sort of fully capture what you're going for. It is useful to know you can zoom in and take closer pictures if you want to get higher resolution on some aspects, but you do need interpolated steps in between each. So I'm going to show a video of demonstrating how I took pictures of the Diabloceratops. It is in a different room, so it's not the ideal setup. I'm a little too close to the Diabloceratops, but you'll be able to see and get a general idea of how you want to approach this taking pictures in rings. The key is to do it in rings at different levels. So I'm just going to demonstrate part of a ring here. You would start, take a picture, and then hold it at the same level, move a little bit, take a picture. I'm not really far enough out because I don't have space here, but get the idea. And then just do that all the way around. And then in order to get the bottom features, you would just go point up, take a picture, move, stay at about the same level, and keep going. And make sure you get about 25 to 30 pictures per ring. If you want to get more detail by zooming in, you can't just take a picture and then go in close and take a picture. You have to give the program something to interpolate. So you take your picture, take a picture, take a picture, and then do that again in rings like everything else. If you need top features or bottom features, you can sort of do a ring over. I can't do that in this position, but to give you an idea. So a turntable setup is going to work a little differently. You can see in the picture here, I have a light box that has no background, as mentioned, which is very necessary if you're going to be rotating your specimen. And the light box also creates a very diffuse lighting environment. So there's still a little bit of a shadow, but it's very minimized. I also have my camera on a tripod, and then I actually have this camera connected to a computer with a program that I'll show in a second that just makes taking photos faster. I cover up the light box with this white tablecloth just to help increase sort of the diffuseness and evenness of the lighting on this turtle shell that I am showing here. Some components that I want to get but I haven't gotten quite yet that are very useful. One is a turntable, so you don't have to physically turn the specimen. You can just put it on the table and rotate that as you take pictures. And then the other was actually a suggestion from Michigan, which is these fake ice cubes. Because they're transparent, the photogrammetry program won't pick up on them. And you can actually use them to elevate your specimen off the turntable and sort of make the cropping of the final mesh you get a lot easier. So I definitely want to get some of those, and I recommend trying them out. They're pretty cheap. So the sort of best practices taken directly from Michigan that you want to do with this is to basically do each ring in one of three camera positions and then repeat that for the flip side of the object. This is also an advantage of using this sort of setup, which is that you can get the bottom of objects. So here I've got the camera essentially flat, perpendicular to the turtle shell in the light box. Here I've moved it up a bit and then tilted it down to get more of a top angle. And then here I moved it up and pointed it down even more to get yet another angle. So about three rings was recommended. I did have some success with taking just two rings. And then, of course, flipping over the turtle shell and doing each set of rings on both sides of the turtle shell. And that the program did manage to stitch together, again, with the key being the blank background so that it only has the turtle shell color information and parallax to worry about. The way I found this to work the easiest was basically to have the camera at one level, take a ring of the turtle shell on one side, take a ring of the turtle shell on the other side, and then move the camera up a level and repeat that. One of the great benefits of photogrammetry over surface scanning is that you do not have to worry if something wobbles out of place a little bit. The algorithm, the process of photogrammetry sort of accounts for that. If you're working with this turntable setup, there's this really useful free program that allows you to sort of speed up your camera picture-taking workflow. It's called Digicam Control, and I'll put a link to it in the description. Essentially, it just allows you to plug any DSLR camera into your computer via USB, and then do all your camera control on your computer rather than having to do it on the camera. So here I've got it pulled up. Unfortunately, I don't have the camera connected right now, but you should still be able to get the basics. Here's the viewport with recent pictures. Here we have the camera, and any DSLR camera you plug in should show up there. This unfortunately does not work with phone cameras, just DSLR. And then here's where things get really useful. So you can create these sessions. You can specify the session name, the session folder, and then a file name template. So since you're going to be taking tens, hundreds of photos for one object, it's useful to be able to set the name to something specific and then have each photo just count up. So you can just set that counter at one, and then each time you take a picture, it'll add one to it. Once you have the session set up, you can go into the live view for the camera. Now, of course, nothing is showing up here right now since I don't have a camera, but we can still look at the controls. Here's where you can control everything like ISO, shutter speed, aperture, which is all really great for getting more specific tweaking of how your photographs look. Here we have sort of capture delay and capture count. So one thing I found really helpful is you can set your capture count to like 20 and then your delay to 5 seconds, and it'll just take a picture every 5 seconds. So all you have to do is rotate as it takes each picture. There's also this focus button where in the view of the picture, you can sort of double click on to select an area you want to focus on and then just have the camera focus on that. So that's really helpful for taking a lot of pictures in a row, and you can see sort of an example of what that would look like here. One final thing to note, if you are going to be using a DSLR camera, they tend to work better because they record a lot of the metadata that photogrammetry programs actually use to calculate camera position. You don't get that with a phone camera, and it doesn't like make the phone camera completely unusable, but it just makes DSLRs work a little better. Another advantage you get with DSLRs is that you have more control over sort of the different camera settings. So one is just picking a good lens, and you want a lens with as little distortion as possible. So something like a 60 millimeter is really ideal, so you're not getting sort of a fisheye distortion on every image. In terms of the camera settings, a lower ISO and a sort of slower shutter speed to make sure you're getting a lot of light into the camera for each picture, as long as you're in conditions where that's doable. And then you want a very small aperture, because you're going to want as much of the object in focus at once as possible. So those are sort of the main settings to think about. I am by no means a camera expert, so definitely experiment with your own setups. But always go back to the stuff we talked about in the beginning, where you want to keep both parallax and color matching in mind as you're going about setting up your photogrammetry.